Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for listening to the show. On the show this week, Hayden Sammak. Really cool guy. Awesome dude. Great conversation. Great conversations I had with him, actually. I'll talk more about that in a minute. But he plays music under the name Deadfellow. Hayden Sammak. We're going to talk more about him in just a second. But first off, how's everyone doing? Is it hot? It's very hot. If you're on the East Coast right now, it's insanely hot. And I am sitting in the basement right now, like I do, because this is where I do the show. And I'm leaning back in my chair, which I've been doing for the last couple of intros. And I think it's really improving things. And I have the air conditioner running. Normally, I turn all that crap off when I record, but I'm just not today. It's too hot. So if that comes on, it's just that's a sound that we're going to deal with. Because it's hot, and I'm not turning the air conditioner off. I'm sitting here in the basement, leaning back in the chair. I'm wearing these running shorts that I would never, ever wear in public, outside of the house. I don't even think I'd get the mail in these shorts. But that's how hot it is. You wear things in your house to combat the uncomfortableness of heat. And you wear things in your house that you would never wear anywhere else. And that's just your thing. That's your coping mechanism. I don't even know why I own these shorts. I think what happened was at one point in my varying enthusiasms about fitness, I saw these shorts, thought to myself, not only am I going to run regularly enough to own these shorts, but at some point my body will make these shorts a good idea. And the moral of that story is do not buy aspirational fitness clothing. Just don't do it. It will make you even more depressed than buying regular aspirational clothing, because not only does it remind you that you're not fitting the clothes the way you'd like to, that you're not doing the proper exercise which the clothes were bought for to obtain that. It's this whole cycle. Don't do it. Don't buy them. That's my message to you all. Anyway, let's talk of other things. Let's talk of 25oclockpod.com. That's our home on the internet, and you can do a lot of things at 25oclockpod.com. You can check out the archives. Every episode is up there for streaming or download. All of them. 72? I think this is episode 72. Again, I should know these things. I should have checked them, but I didn't. But anyway, in the archives, all the episodes, streaming and downloading, and you can sign up for the mailing list, and you can check out Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. I have all these things. They're there. Society has told me that because I have a thing on the internet, I have to have these other things. So I do, and I don't mind them too much. They're pretty cool. I'm actually really digging my Instagram. I never would have thought that was a thing that I would be into, but here we are. Anyway, go to 25oclockpod.com for all those things. Before we talk about Hayden, real quick, a little plug for the show, as if the show is not just one giant plug for itself. July 14th, I will be taking part in the 5th annual Philadelphia Podcast Festival. Go to phillypodfest.com for more information on that. I will be doing a live show, a live 25 o'clock at Bridge Set Sound at 8 p.m. on July 14th. Joining me also that night will be the gentleman of the Great Albums podcast. They'll be doing a live episode. And the gentleman of the Bridge Set Sound podcast. That's the official podcast of the Bridge Set Sound Music Store, which is where we'll be doing the show. And I've talked about Great Albums before. You all know how much I love them and how much I love their show. Don't sleep on the Bridge Set Sound podcast, especially if you're a Philadelphia area music person. These guys are great. They bring a lot of their personality into it. They talk about stuff in the shop. They talk about music. They talk about cool people they know. They have these cool people on the show. Hint, hint, guys, you should have me on the show soon. You know, we could tie that in. It could be a promotional thing. Guys, Bridge Set Sound guys, it's time for me to be on the show. Steve was on my show, the owner of Bridge Set Sound and the guy in the Bridge Set Sound podcast. He was on my show. He was episode 2. I know, right? Let that sink in. Steve, you were episode 2. And now we're episode 72, I think. Anyway, that's July 14th. I'll be plugging that more as it goes along. Go to phillypodfest.com for more information. Okay, let's talk about Hayden. Let's talk about Deadfellow. You can get all his music, all the stuff at deadfellow.com. His music's on Spotify, on iTunes, all those places. He has a new record coming out June 23rd. It's called Mesa California, California Dream. We talk a lot about the record, the concept of the record, what he's going for with the record. You'll hear it all. Interesting thing to know about this conversation that I have with Hayden. He came twice. He came here twice. I've never done that before. Let me give you a little background on that, because I'm just going to stitch the conversations together. We're going to end the first conversation. You're going to hear a little music, and then we're just going to go right into the second conversation we're having. The reason I did this was the first time he came, it was good. You're going to hear a lot of great stuff in that conversation. It was a really good conversation. But we were having tech issues on my end, and you might hear it a little bit in there. This is the only time I'll ever call attention to that, but I just want you to know the story. I was having some tech issues with the microphones and the unit and all that. It was frustrating. He was having a day, and things were making him late, so he didn't get here till a bit later than we had planned, and then he had to be somewhere else. So we were tight for time, and I think we were both just distracted that day. I mean, he had told me before, he was texting me, that he was having a bit of a day, and I had been having a bit of a day, and like I said, our first conversation was great, and I really think it would have stood on its own. But as we were leaving, we were both talking about, like, yeah, this could have been better. Like, we both felt out of sorts, and it wasn't either of our faults. It just, sometimes that's just how it goes. So I said, yeah, why don't you come back in a few weeks, and we'll talk some more. And I wanted him to play, and he didn't have time to play. So he came back, and it was great. And I'm glad he did, and he played, and he came back actually the night before his record release show at Milk Boy. So that was cool. We talk a lot about his band and about just doing shows like that. So, hey, this is a first time for everything, and this is the first time I ever had a guest back for a second time for the same interview. And I think it worked out great. So like I said, check out his music, Deadfellow, deadfellow.com. But here's my conversations with Hayden Sammak. Here on 25 o'clock. Five. You got something at the beginning of June, right?
Yeah, in the beginning of June, we're doing a record release at Milk Boy.
That's where.
And then, you know, we got some, like, yeah, well, that freaked me out because, like,
no,
you know, well, because
I didn't mean to tell you were playing somewhere that you weren't playing.
Well, we have some tentative dates, that are, you know, yet to be announced. And I thought that somehow you had, like,
no, I barely know about you that are actually happening.
I was like, you know, is my band's in town giving me away?
No. I, you know, 100-150 cap rooms, they all start to run together.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I'm going to play Mercury Lounge. Have you ever been there?
Yeah.
Is that cool? I've never played it.
This is going to make me sound old. I haven't been there since 1999.
Okay, well, how was it in 1999?
It was pretty badass, but I was 19, and I thought everything in New York was badass. Yeah. Then, so for all I know, it was like totally not.
I've never been to New York City.
Really?
I've never been. I have never been. Well, that's not entirely true. I was there once when I was in sixth grade on like a class trip
to like the Statue of Liberty.
Yeah.
Or something.
Well,
like
no,
that.
We didn't even get that far. We like went into like the Empire State Building, and then we had like this dinner at like a dinosaur, or no, was it? It was like Mars, like some Martian themed like restaurant. It was like,
well, in your sixth grade, that's probably like the coolest shit ever.
Oh, when I was in sixth grade, that shit was bitching. Yeah.
Oh my god, I can't, you go where you go, but like I find that interesting that like you've never been to New York, and a musician like yourself, but like, hey, Mercury Lounge is a good first place to play. I tell you that much.
Yeah, no,
it's better than any first place I ever played in New York.
Well, no,
not to smear the places that I played in New York Mercury Lounge is a real deal. I don't remember who I saw there, but it was CMJ 99, and I probably saw a bunch of like bands at the time that we all thought were the biggest deal that have probably broken up at this point, and nobody remembers who they are.
Yeah, well, you know, unfortunately, that's the reality for a lot of bands. Yeah, no, I'm super excited. You know, you know, go to New York City.
Yeah.
Well, actually, you know what? I'm going to New York City on Friday. I got to talk with some subsection of some media thing that mm-hmm. I like got convinced was like a good idea. And
oh, what did you throw in like for the promo package?
Well, what it was,
you found a like a promo company or a media company.
Yeah. Not like, you know, it's like nothing crazy.
It's oh,
like,
no, no, like, but it's
pitching like,
yeah.
you know, tens of thousands of dollars at it. But we, you know, yeah, we,
you threw some money at it.
Well, yeah,
at some guys who are going to take care of some stuff for you. Yeah.
Yeah. I had some leftover, budget from like the recording that mm-hmm. I had, you know, so I was like, all right, well, you know, I could buy a guitar or I can like try and give this thing some legs.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or I was thinking about an iPhone. Maybe.
There you go. You're your own manager with an iPhone.
Yeah, right? That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
Well, because we were sending emails back and forth, and I kept looking at the bottom. I'm like, wait, is this name Hayden or this other name right here?
Yeah.
And I didn't know, and I didn't... If it had gone on for too much longer, I was finally just going to be like, all right, buddy, you got to tell me what your real name is.
Yeah, no. No, before I had any management, I was convinced that... only people with managers got cool gigs. So I made a fictitious management account.
You're not the first.
And actually, just today, I switched it over and went from management@deadfellow.com to Hayden@deadfellow.com.
Yeah.
And now it is much more clear. And
we know where I'm. Well, guys, look, and both names start with an H. Like, it was the guy, like, you made it like a Harrison.
Yeah, it's my little brother's name.
Oh, cool. Yeah. But I'm looking at this, I'm just like, I don't. Because you're signing everything off Hayden, but yeah. then there was the e-signature at the bottom. Yep, and I kind of assumed everything you just told. I'm like, he probably made that up so that he could, like, because it's hard. People have a hard time talking to the band because they're just like, oh, I don't want to tell him no, and I don't want to tell him yes, so I just won't tell him anything.
Yeah.
And then you end up throwing all this, you end up doing a push, and no one gets back to you because no one can just be like, I'm just going to tell this guy what I think.
Yeah.
I used to do similar things. Well, when I was in a band, there was no one's name attached to it.
Right, you could just kind of
be like, oh, this is Dan with the band. And they're just like, what do you do? A lot of things.
Yeah. When you're doing like a solo project like mm-hmm. this, I mean, like, you know, it's easier to take stuff personally, you know. Yeah. I mean, a lot of it doesn't bother me, right?
It's your stuff, though. It's like, it's your art, you know?
Yeah. I mean, but fuck it. Like, a lot of people don't like me, you know what I mean? So like, you know, it's whatever. If they don't people aren't going to like, you know, the art. Or maybe they like the music and maybe they don't like me. Or maybe they like me and they don't like the music, you know?
Yeah. Maybe it's a combination of all the permutations of the two.
All you can do is just, you know, try and be nice to people and see what happens. You know? Try and make good music and see what happens for that matter. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, absolutely. Well, let's go back. Sure. Where are you from originally?
I'm from Ambler, but Pennsylvania. But I feel like I really grew up in like the Jenkintown, like sort of Mount Airy area.
Just like north of the city.
Yeah, because I went to high school like kind of far away from where I lived, so all my like high school friends lived in like Jenkintown and mm-hmm. Abington. So yeah, that is where I grew up.
Yeah, it's I say this every time it comes up. I said, like, there's in the music scene here in this city, there's a lot of people who just come from like an hour to an hour and a half away from the city, because this was your city. Like, why? You didn't have to, like if you lived in Wisconsin, like, you didn't have to move all the way across the country to New York City or Los Angeles. Like, you were just like, well, closest city is that way.
Well, you know, I actually did make, you know, I wish my, like, fucking, like, growing up story wasn't just, like, so fucking unremarkable.
No, most are.
Yeah, I know. Well, I guess that's kind of charming in and of itself, right? Initially, when I moved, you know, away after high school, I moved to Florida.
Oh.
Because I was like, yeah, it's going to be like the endless summer, and, you know, they're going to be like mad chicks, and like, it's going to be great. And then, like...
Did you go to school down there?
Yeah. And then I went to, like, you know, fucking Tampa, dude. And, like, that was not like the endless summer. That was like the hood and a bay, and then, like, just like a drinking culture that was like very shallow. You know what I mean? Like, it was just like, I like to drink and do shit, you know. I actually haven't even been drinking lately, but, you know, like, I like to drink and do things. Yeah. I don't like to just drink.
You like to drink and socialize and have a...
Yeah, yeah.
Have an activity involved.
One thing that we used to do that was, like, pretty fun was we would go late at night with flashlights onto golf courses.
Oh.
And we drink, and we would shine...
A lot of golf courses in Tampa.
Yeah, we would shine the... the alligator eyes on like the edges of the bank, and because there would be baby alligators in the springtime, so you could, you know, shine the light and you could catch these little baby alligators. And
what did you do with the alligators?
Well, I mean, you just catch them and you take a picture,
and
you're
like, look,
I
have a baby alligator. And
yeah,
what happens if I don't know? I don't want to screw around with baby animals, especially at night, because if they're parent animal wakes up.
Oh, and their parent animal is an alligator.
Yeah,
too,
your parent animal. So. Really, any parent animal, like, is just like, I don't want to, like, even like parent birds, like,
yeah,
they would probably
be
a thing to deal with. But, like, well, yeah, parent alligator wakes up and says, hey.
I don't think that they really have, like, that kind of. I don't really know what it is. And anyway, I mean, like, we were very gentle with these things.
Yeah, no, you guys weren't being dicks. You're just like, hey, look, they're cool.
Yeah, it's like a cool, like, novel experience. And then, like, one day, like, we were doing this. And they're so, like, the baby alligator's eyes are like 2 inches apart, right? Because they have like these like oversized heads. And then I was like, and they're only about like, you know, maybe a foot and a half long, mm-hmm. you know. And so then, like, one day I was like, oh, that one looks like it had a little more space in between its eyes, like 3 inches or so. And I was like, okay, so that must be like a 2 foot or 3 footer, you know. And so I like, it was like halfway under lily pads. I kind of like jumped on it from behind, and it's not proportionate like that. As it turns out, like, this thing was like 6 fucking
feet long.
Oh, jeez.
That was like an adult or a medium, a teenage alligator.
Yeah. And like, luckily it was in like, you know, a foot and a half of water. So like, I like jumped on it and I grabbed it. It just kind of like rolled onto its back, and I like had it around its like mouth. Cause like, you know, and yeah. And then like, so eventually like, I just kind of like elbowed my way up onto, like, you know, the thing. And I mean, like,
are you carrying this alligator with you the entire time?
Well, I'm certainly holding, because I don't want to be in the water
with
like this thing. And like, so I you know, and more like 4 or 5 feet, if I'm
it's
being
still,
like,
it's still, it's longer
than a
foot.
It was still a larger alligator than
that's
I
the size
anticipated,
of a person,
right?
Yeah.
I mean, everything's fine. I still have all my fingers, but yeah.
You're here, so, you know.
While we're talking about Tampa, there's a crazy story, and I'm sure this will be edited, so this rambling will.
No, it's all there, man. That's your alligator story right there. I've never touched an alligator of any size, so.
I would suggest it. You know, go ahead, do it.
Oh God, I don't find myself with many opportunities to touch alligators. Mm. Although, I mean, if I went down to Florida, then you know.
Also, like, you know, you really shouldn't disturb animals in the wild. Like,
no.
But I mean, like, it was in a golf course, you know?
Yeah, but that was their wild once.
Yeah.
Someone decided otherwise.
Yeah. Just a public disclaimer. I accept responsibility for what I did. And in the future, I would recommend that no one go touching baby animals in the woods, because there are real environmental consequences. Yeah. I understand that. Please don't leave me hate messages on my Facebook.
Isn't it ridiculous that you have to make a disclaimer? Be like, I am not hunting alligators every week.
Yeah, no, like, that is not something.
This
that I
was
do.
A few isolated incidents in my youth, and no one was hurt.
Yeah,
that's right. Someone later would be like, "Well, I liked his music, but then I found out about his stance on baby alligators, and I just can't."
I just can't get down with that.
And then your label drops you, and, like, you know, it's done. But getting back to, like, so you're growing up in Ambler.
Yeah.
You're living outside the city. Mm-hmm. Did the city kind of play a part in you growing up, like, from music and seeing bands and things like that?
No, I was never, you know, I never really came down to the city ever, you know, when I was growing up, you know, just because, I don't know, my friends and I didn't do that. We were little dickheads around, like, Jenkintown. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. You know, we were just like, you know.
Was the city still kind of gnarly to you guys then back then? How old are you?
I am 25.
Okay. So it was getting better around the time. That, so that
it,
was.
It had nothing to do. It had nothing to do with that. When I was younger, I used to, you know, in high school, we used to volunteer with like Meals on Wheels, and there was this particular organization that made like meals for like I guess it might have just been Meals on Wheels in general. We were assembling like, you know, essentially hot meals for people in like hospice, and then there was this like homeless shelter that like, you know, we helped out at, you know, because we were just doing like community service with like the school or whatever. So like my actually only experiences as far as Philadelphia went really were like in the realm of like community service.
Oh, okay.
Or like sometimes we would, you know, I would come down and see like, you know, like a show or something like that, you know, but like a big show, not like, you know, like 150, not like a cool show.
you come down, like see something like at the Electric Factory or something like that.
You know, not even. The first time I was in the Electric Factory was I went to see Courtney Barnett last, I guess, May-ish or whenever she was.
It was a great show that I did not go to.
Yeah, no, it was super awesome.
Yeah, no, she's phenomenal.
Oh, Courtney Barnett is the truth.
Yeah, the first time I heard her, it was that song about like having a reaction while gardening. The first time I heard it, I thought it was the stupidest song I'd ever heard in my life. Like I got through it, and I'm like, the fuck was that?
Yeah.
And then because XPN kind of plays the crap out of stuff sometimes.
Yeah.
But
shout out to XPN.
Yeah, but they played it enough that like I think maybe around the fifth time it was on, because I was driving truck for a restaurant company.
Radishes.
I was just thinking about radishes, and somewhere on like the fifth time I heard it, in probably the course of a week, I was just like, no, this is the coolest song I've ever heard in my life, and it reminded me so much. I'm like, you know what? I'm like, this reminds me of like the Vaselines and the Go-Betweens and the Clean and all that. And then I found out she was Australian. I was just like, well, I just named three Australian bands right there, so this makes a lot of sense. Yeah. Like, and then I was just, boom, I was hook, line, and sinker.
Yeah. You know, her and Kurt Vile are actually in the studio together. Yeah, apparently. I saw something on Pitchfork or some similar blog, and I actually like posted it online, and then I'm friends with his brother Sammy, and Sammy goes, "No way!" And I was like, "That's, you know, that's but funny."
But how much does Kurt Vile like tell everyone, every family member that he has who's going in the studio?
Well,
with?
I think Kurt is one of like Sammy's like 12 brothers and sisters.
Oh, I didn't know he came from a big family.
I should really get
him on the show. You should talk about it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Kurt or Sammy.
I'll tell Sammy. I'll be like, yo, man, listen to this podcast. Yeah. And like,
yeah. No, but that makes a lot of sense for them to work together, because they have this very almost ramshackle, lackadaisical approach to just playing. And so like that makes a lot of sense. I'd be very excited to hear.
Yeah,
what they did. So when you finally did, I mean, so what is your trajectory then? So you grew up in Ambler, went to Florida. Did you finish? Did you just kind of come back? You're just like,
I just 2 years, and then I came back, and then like,
so you're like 20, and you came back home, 2021. Yeah,
yeah, and then so I came back home, and then. And then, like, I went to school at Philadelphia University for a year. Mm-hmm. And then, get this, I decided that I needed money, so I should start playing music.
Interesting. Tell me more.
So, I don't know. Like, I had a guitar in, like, college and, like, you know, played it. Like,
yeah, when did guitar start? Did it start in college or before?
Like, you know, I, like, knew a couple chords in high school.
Were you in, like, bands or something? Like, they're, like, playing friends in high school?
No. None of that. But the, you know, when I was like, I guess right about when I was like 21, I like was like, oh, like I'm gonna write songs now, and like so I just started writing songs, and then I just like I like viciously imitated Bob Dylan for like a year and a half. But
I feel like Lou Reed was doing it too, even though he didn't realize.
Well,
it.
Yeah.
I think
definitely.
A lot of people did. Like he was such a.
Well, how could you not? You know what I mean?
He's such an important songwriter figure, and whether, you know, some people love him, some people don't, but, like, you know, you can't you can't deny the influence that he's had.
I just knew that like it was accessible to me to write in that way because like I was an English major, so
so was I.
So I like to think that I'm like kind of nice with words. So that was something that was like, easy for me to do, like with my like lack of real guitar skill, and I still don't. I'm still not a very good guitar player, but yeah. And then so I was in like denial about this, and after doing that for like a year and a half, I was like, hey, I'm just like not gonna play music for like a couple years, and until I can like approach it like really fresh. And so in like, you know, 2014, 2015, you know, I came back and, you know, tried to sound more like myself. And here we are.
It's stuck.
Yeah, and it stuck.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the EP, so when did you put out that? Because that EP came out like late 2016, right?
Yeah, it came out in December.
Yeah. Which is... And I'm blanking on what it's called. I've listened to it twice. I can't remember.
It's Love Songs for the Contemporary Listener.
That's a great title.
Thanks.
I was listening to it actually yesterday on the train on the way back from New York City. And I was listening to this thing and I was just like, and I'd listened to it once before, but I'd had it on while I was doing something else.
Right,
listening to it, hearing it. But, you know, sometimes that's the joy of... I think this is a joy of public transit or like driving your car, like doing a commute where like if you're going to put music on or something like that.
Yeah,
like
it's you just, listen for real.
It's just you and the thing. And sometimes I'll find myself listening to things that I've listened to a million times before and finding new stuff. And sometimes I'll find myself really connecting with stuff I've never heard before. And then when I try and go and recreate that situation later, I'm like, I don't know what it was, Ben, but
yeah,
it seems to be gone.
Yeah.
But I just from listening to it, I thought to myself, I'm like, and I've been on a big Mark Lanegan kick lately, so and that's a comparison that I've read that other people have drawn to as well, because you have kind of that deeper voice and you sing about depressing shit.
I don't know Mark.
No, that's okay. No, that's the best part. That's the best part. You know, you don't whisper it. Like you see, like you don't listen to Mark Lanegan.
No, I just don't know who what band is
he fronted a band called the Screaming Trees.
Oh, okay. I've heard people tell me something about Screaming Trees.
He was also in a great duo with Greg Dooley from the Afghan Whigs.
Oh, that's cool.
Called Gutter Twins.
Fuck yeah. There's this,
and he sings. You know this Queens of the Stone Age album, Lullabies to Paralyze?
Yeah.
That first like classical guitar song where there's a guy singing really deeply?
Yeah.
That's Mark Lanegan.
Oh, okay. Yep. All right.
So he's been around forever, and he has a very distinct, you know, moody voice.
Yeah.
And he was just on Marc Maron like this month and all that.
Okay. I'll have to check him out.
He's a dude I've dug for a long time. And so immediately upon hearing your music, I immediately went the Mark Lanegan and like Nick Cave kind of route right there.
Well, that's like the other thing. Like people say Nick Cave, and that's another person that I don't listen to. And like, here's the fucked up thing is like, I want to listen to these guys, but like, you know,
are you afraid now that it's going to like kind of ruin it?
No, I feel as if like I have the potential to be like, you know, if I like really get into that, like, you know, to kind of get over influenced by
it's true,
you know,
yeah,
so I'm just
possible.
Like, you know, people are telling me that I sound like them and that seems like good company. And like, that's how I want to keep it, you know,
and it's sort of Leonard Cohen-esque and all that.
Yeah.
And, it's that sort of, you know, introspective moody darkness that, you know, you could rattle off, you know, tons of different kinds of people who sound like that. But I wrote down right here, the first thing I wrote, so sort of a window into my process right here, is that the first thing I always write under your name is just, and I ask everyone this, I don't know why I have to write it down, is that kind of beginning rigmarole. Where are you from? What are you about?
Yeah,
you know, early experiences in music, songwriting, stuff like that. And then I start to write the meat of the questions. The first thing I wrote after the obligatory where are you from stuff.
It was like, have you ever wrestled alligators?
Stop reading the questions. It ruins everything. I wrote, I said, darkness and longing.
Yeah.
And then I wrote, and this is a strange question. It could not even be applicable. Like, do you got to go deep for that? Are you just find yourself a somewhat moody individual or...
No, I'm just like a pretty like sad dude.
I mean, it's fine.
You know what I mean? Like, you know, and like people like are like, you know, I mean, it's like, it's not,
you don't have
really
to go far. It's kind of just right there. Just
it's
ready
it's
to
just
be tapped.
Like, it's just like an existential sadness, man. Like, it's not like, you know, my days really aren't that bad. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, most of my days are actually really nice, you know? But I don't know.
Yeah. There's just like, there's a dark moodiness in there. And, you know, I always feel that anyone, when I talk to songwriters, and like, this isn't really straying far off the path from what I'm used to either, is you get guys who just like, well, yeah, I'm bummed, but you know, things are okay. Like, you know, bummed in the way that any of us get, you know, that any of us get sad or get, you know, down or, you know, weary of whatever. Because there's a lot to make one weary.
You know, it's just, I guess, you know what, I'm bummed about the fact that this seems like an impossible, like, you know, it seems like falling in love is like an impossibility with the nature of, like, you know, my peer, like the generation, like that I'm involved in, you know, like that. I think like that's like kind of, and it's not that it makes me sad. Is like, you know, I don't like sit
you
in
feel
my
like
room.
You're missing
like,
something though, like something simpler. Or
it's not even like I'm missing it. It's like I feel like collectively, like we're missing it.
Oh,
you know,
because you're all so tuned into each other that like,
well, everything is just like so quick. You know what
fairly
I mean?
And quick usually leads to superficial.
Exactly,
because you don't have time. I mean, going back when we were talking about like stuff in the music press, that stuff comes out so fast. Yeah. Just in the regular press, stuff comes out so fast, and you're supposed to have a reaction or a stance to it immediately.
Yeah.
And then you need to move on. Or like how fast records come out sometimes, and how fast people expect you to have an opinion about it. Yeah. Like when Kendrick Lamar's To Pimp a Butterfly came out, and everyone was anxiously awaiting it, and it was out on like a Tuesday.
Yeah.
And like, Tuesday afternoon, I was getting bombarded with like texts and little messages on Facebook amongst my various record nerd friends who were just like, have you heard it? What do you think? What do you think yet? And I'm just like, guys, number one, no, I haven't. I'm at work. Yeah. And number two, I'm not going to be like, I know kind of the depth of Kendrick Lamar. I'm like, I'm not going to be able to have an opinion about this for at least a week.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I'm going to have to listen to this like 10 times because I knew what he was doing.
Yeah.
And I feel that way, you know, with a lot. I'm sure you feel that way with a lot of artists too. Just like,
yeah,
I can't have an opinion on first listen.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's pretty much impossible.
But I get what you're saying.
Well,
about,
it's just like the immediacy of the generation prevents, you know, any sort of anything beyond like a reactionary, you know, sort of impulse.
You've
got to
get what you want.
Well, it's just like, it's like, I can type 160 words a minute. I'm a really fast, like, you know, typist. Wow. And
I'm so glad that alligator didn't take your hand.
Yeah, right. Yes. My secretarial job would be in total jeopardy. But I'm a really fast typist, right? So I, you know, I fire off an email to someone and it gets to them instantly, right? Yeah, yeah. So, you know, from start to finish, you know, I can write a big long thought in, you know, just no time at all, and they're reading in no time at all. But, you know, to like write a letter, right? You know, it's like for each word that I write by hand, I can write 20 probably.
Yeah.
In like, you know, or maybe not 20, but like
you
10
can type,
or so.
Yeah, you can type 10 words in the
so
time.
So it really
it
makes you consider each word, and it makes you really consider an entire thought, because, you know, by the time that you finish that handwritten sentence, you know, you kind of start thinking about like, oh, is that exactly what I mean? And then you, you know, kind of start over. And there's something like beautiful and really thoughtful. And, you know, I think, you know, I think that that's the kind of attention to detail that, you know, the like love or something like it requires. Yeah. And I'm scared for like this, like the for like the Tinder generation, dude.
Yeah. I've never heard it described like that. I've been married 11 years.
That's great. Yeah, congratulations. I mean,
I'm 36, so it wasn't you know, we didn't just get together. But back when, and I say this all the time to like the young guys that I work with or the people that I meet in the music world, I said like, I don't know how you guys can, like, I don't know how you do it. I couldn't do it. Like, it was hard enough to do it in the late 90s, early 2000s, like when I was, you know, in my very late teens and early 20s and going to college and meeting girls and stuff like that. Like, even that, like at that time, even like, you know, the rise of AOL Instant Messenger was like kind of a disruption where you're just like, well, wow, maybe we don't have to have all the thought. You still had to meet your people. Like, you still had to call them on the phone. You still had to do all these things. Like, and if people, I was talking with with another musician. His name is Brian. He plays under the name A Day Without Love.
Oh, yeah, I know Brian.
And he was talking about how the inherent flakiness of his generation, where they just like, you just don't show up for stuff. Like, four people will say, yeah, we'll all meet at this bar on this at this time. And then you show up and like two people show up.
Yeah.
And the other two people, no word, like, no, hey, I'm not going to make it. Or, hey, I got to do something else. You just don't show up.
Yeah.
Which in like my day, like if four of us agreed to, in my day, my God. But like when I was 22, if four of us agreed to meet at a place and only two of us showed up, that would be cause for alarm.
Oh, yeah.
Like we would be like running around just being like, where's so-and-so?
Yeah, right.
I get it. I guess there's an immediacy to, like experience and response. So like if you meet some, I don't know, do you at your age when you meet someone, or do you expect it to like,
well,
it's just got to be clicking quickly and like,
I mean, you know, it's like, I guess it kind of believes in like, you know, or it's kind of like, you know, do people believe in love and first sight, you know, because if so, like that immediacy really shouldn't be a problem.
Yeah.
Right. But if not, if you think it takes a little longer, then like that immediacy is going to get in the way. It's kind of like everyone is like, you know, with the level of communication that you have so quickly, everyone might as well just be sleeping with each other on like the first date. you know what I mean? It's like that. It kind of like ruins something.
There's,
you know,
yeah, well, almost. I mean, there's something to be said for getting to know each other, to like knowing stuff before you just kind of rush into that thing. And whether it is the most important thing or not the most important thing in a relationship, I mean, there's many schools of thought on that, but I just like, and this is probably something that like someone of our like grandparents' generation would have said. They're just like, well, you can't just don't give it all away.
Giving it all away is like fucking fine. I mean, like you know what I mean. If like you guys are just like trying to like get down, then like, you know, go ahead, get down. Like that's cool. Like everyone,
I guess,
as long as everyone involved
has the same expectations, I imagine.
Yeah,
then
but
it's
just
fine.
Like, you know, I don't know. It's just like the way that things are going right now, man, is just like tragic to me. Like the idea of it.
Gotcha.
You know, plain and simple, and like existentially as a whole. Seeing like the way that people are acting and like, you know, the lack of the way that the social climate is like, you have these two schools of thought that are just like, you know, it's like the ultra, you know, PC and like the ultra, like, you know, just fuck it, whatever. And like, we're just like diverging in these like insane fucking ways, you know, and like ultimately, you know, that's going to breed a generation without any sort of unity or any sort of, I don't know. Now I'm like fucking rambling.
Well, no, I definitely get what you're saying. And bringing it back to like kind of what sparked us on this, because I asked, where do you tap the darkness that ends up? And when I say, I mean, gosh, it sounds like I'm being dramatic with it, but like there's darkness in your music. And it's powerful and impactful. And I think that's the point. That you're making right there. But I guess you're telling me that you kind of pull this from just kind of looking at the way people treat each other and looking at the way people interact with each other and thinking to yourself like, well, there's got to be something more to it than this. There's got to be a better way. Or,
well, yeah. And, you know, I mean, like, I think there's got to be a better way. And, you know, I think you know, personally, I've been you know, I mean, everyone's been like hurt by somebody.
Yeah,
no, you know,
definitely. I didn't get it right the first time or the fifth time. Like,
yeah. Well, you know, so that's why I'm sad.
It's a totally acceptable reason for being sad.
Yeah.
But to talk to about like the more nitty grittiness to the songs, because as I was listening to them,
even my podcasts are depressing, man.
No, it's cool. You know, I've had some.
Wait till you hear the new album. The new album is going to blow your mind.
I like this one a lot. Yeah.
It's totally different.
Yeah, but it's good. I've had a couple of upbeat podcasts lately, so like I'd like to even it out.
Yeah.
But something I was thinking of when I was listening to it yesterday was that like, the arrangements are very cool. I like the space.
Yeah.
I like the. I'm a big sucker for like spacey, expansive guitar and stuff like that. Echo, reverb, all that stuff. Like that's right up my alley. But as I was listening to it, I thought to myself, I'm like, well, these very cool, and they're not particularly crowded arrangements at all, but I was listening to the arrangements and being like, well, these are very cool, and I like how they stand like this in a record, but as I listened to it, it's like, this would be totally fine, too, like, without some of this window dressing, if it was just like a voice and a, you know, a cleaner guitar or a piano or something like that. In the same way, again, the guy that you don't really listen to, but like in the same way that like Nick Cave can like really just kick it out with his full band, and then he can also bring it right in close with just him and a piano.
Well, that,
any proper singer songwriter can do that. They can work with a large group, or they can just kind of
Well, it's interesting. I like hate playing just a solo guitar. I think that's why I want to learn how to play piano, because I think that is like such a more beautiful just timber of an instrument.
The guitar is a fairly the guitar can be a fairly limiting, not just sonically, but like,
it's just like abrasive to me. Like an acoustic guitar sounds like an acoustic guitar a lot of times, and a lot of times like I don't dig it. The you know, would you believe it if I told you that the next album is like all super elaborate string and horn and like vocal arrangements with like vibraphone.
It's like a Sinatra
and
album is what you're telling me right here.
Yeah.
That's great. Yeah. Is it really?
No, it really is.
Oh shit.
It's or you know what, it's like a Beach Boys.
Oh great. Like kinda, a Brian Wilson thing. Oh, that's wonderful. The one but not happy.
Well it is. It's called Mess California, California Dream. And the last song in the first EP is I Dreamed I Lost My Girl. And like this is that dream. So the first EP is like the idea of like lust like turning into love as the album progresses. You know what I mean? Like Machine is like, there's that girl. Oh my God is like, you know, there's that score, you know. Love Song for the Black on Cherry is like, you know, the kind of turning point where you're like, maybe I could love this person, you know. Same with its intro track, which is Love Song for the Contemporary Listener. Then it goes to She Wears Me, right, which is that holy shit, I'm hook, line, and sinker. And then that I Dreamed I Lost My Girl is like that little bit of paranoia about losing something that you, you know. And so Mess California, California Dream is that dream, right? And that follows, like, this chick, Emily, and she's going to pursue this, like, ever-vague California dream, which is now, like, basically become talentless celebrity, right? You know what I mean? Socialite, for the sake of being a socialite. And it follows her through all that into kind of, like, you know, it resolves itself. And then the, and it's based really heavily. I tried to use like a Beach Boys Pet Sounds soundscape.
Yeah. And that's funny then for it to be like an LA thing, because that was that sort of really tapped a certain sound and feel of LA in the 60s.
Yeah. Well,
and now it's kind of, it's different. It's darker. It's a little more world weary. As time has gone on, and so it's a more world-weary interpretation. I'm saying all these things I haven't actually heard them yet.
Well, it's interesting. It's the opposite. It's trying to capture that like kind of 60s vibe.
Oh, you're trying to capture that kind of sunny California vibe. Because
the whole idea is that, you know, she has gone to California and she's like experiencing this like, you know, new reality of it. But me on the East Coast, having never been there, I'm kind of imagining this like and projecting this like 60s ideal of her having like this like California dream time. But, you know, the reality of it, it's kind of eating her up out there. And eventually, you know, it comes to that like sort of conclusion. So I only listened to the Beach Boys for like 6 months. That's like all I listened to. I hate the Beach Boys. I really do. And like this album actually started because like I tell people I didn't like the Beach Boys, and then they'd like challenge me on it. They'd be like, how can you hate the Beach Boys? I was like, oh, just, you know.
Yeah. I was saying it's not your thing, but yeah.
And I decided like, fuck it, I'm going to qualify myself. I'm only going to listen to the Beach Boys, and then I'm going to make an album entirely influenced by the Beach Boys. And then on the last day of tracking, I sat down at the Keswick Diner, and I was talking to my friend about music, and some guy overheard us talking, and he's like, hey, are you guys musicians? I was like, yeah. He goes, oh, I'm a musician. I go, oh, do you play in a band? He goes, yeah, I'm in the Beach Boys. And it was fucking Bruce Johnston.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah, and I sat down next to Bruce Johnston, and he invited us. We talked for like an hour and a half.
Yeah.
And then he invited me and my buddy Carl over to sound check, and we got to watch that. We ended up meeting John Stamos, which was weird. And so it was kind of like a little
That's wild that you had kind of come. Well, I don't. Did you come around on the end to appreciate the Beach Boys?
Sort of. I told Bruce Johnston that I didn't like the Beach Boys.
Yeah. And what did he say to that?
You could just see it in his face. That was like the first time he's heard that in like 50 years. Like, and I was like,
I mean, you weren't snotty about it. You were just like,
I came around, I like Pet Sounds is like a nice album. I listen to Pet Sounds.
Yeah.
But, and like, that's pretty much all I wanted to, that's been my experience with like the Beach Boys.
Yeah.
But that's like what the new album is kind of like.
Okay, cool.
I should have sent you an advanced copy of it.
No, it's fine. I like you kind of describing it to me from your end. So now when I go into it, I'm gonna have your perspective.
There's a private link on SoundCloud. I'll send that to you tonight. And awesome. If you have time, give it a listen. It's cool.
Yeah. So how do you deal with? Because as I said at the beginning of us talking, like you've had some XPN buzz, you got in Played and stuff like that. And I was just having a discussion with someone just regarding what you do with buzz and what even buzz is, but then like what do you do? So like
you just fucking work harder than everybody else. Like that's what I do, man. Like fucking, you know, I mean like that's what I try and do. You know, I don't know if like I'm accomplishing that, but like, dude, I literally live across the street from the studio now. You know, I spend all my time in the studio.
Which studio?
Kawari Sound Studio.
It's
in Wincote.
Oh, okay.
And, you know, I don't go out anymore, dude. Like, I don't drink anymore. I quit smoking cigarettes. I don't do any drugs anymore. I don't do anything. I just, like, write and work. That's
almost
it.
Almost in a monastic style.
Yeah, like, I mean, like, dude, like, so I had like a 6-song or 7-song EP come out in December. I have one coming out in June. I got another one coming out in November.
Oh, cool. Oh, so you just
It's called Millennials in Love and Other Pre-Apocalyptic Standards.
That's great. I like this sort of classic album title approach that you have right there, which is very, very Sinatra-esque. But that's great. That's very cool. Are they all sort of interconnected?
Yeah, they're a linear trilogy. If you all three of them lined up front to back.
Yeah.
I mean, if you listen to each one on its own, you get like a little story. Yeah. But if you listen to all of them together,
each one are self-contained, but they can also be a whole.
Right. You get a character arc.
Oh, that's interesting.
Or not a character arc, but you get a plot arc.
Yeah, some sort of narrative beginning, middle, and end. Mm-hmm. That's very cool, and it definitely requires. Speaking in the opposite of what you're saying about everything being immediate and like having to immediately like have an opinion about stuff, a work like that or a series of works like that meant to intertwine is going to require something of the listener. You know, we're not going to we can't just listen to one song off of each of them and like have an idea of what's going on.
Going back to buzz, I mean, if someone's going to hear that and like hold me to some like, you know, expectation that they, you know, kind of like wrote out song, you know, then like I have the right to hold them to an expectation of like really spending time with it, you know. I mean, like, and it won't be for everyone, you know, and it's not for everyone, but you know.
Yeah, but you made the work, you spent the time writing, rewriting, editing, and like making it what you want.
People who
it's not too much to ask for someone to give it more than just like
it's not even that. It's just like if you want it, it's there for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, if you don't want it, fine. I don't care. You know, like, that's cool. That's cool too. I wish you'd like, you know,
I hope you want it, but like, you're not going to belabor the point, and you're not going to alter things about it to make more people want it.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like you said, like this is the music you make. And if you're there, if you're in, yay, good. This is for you. If not, okay, sorry.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not for you. The idea that everything you make has to be for everybody. It has to have mass appeal. Like,
no, it's fucking bullshit.
Well, yeah. And the fact that like mass appeal is so much more in the reach of people now, just with the internet and all that, where you could.
It's the dumbest shit. It's the dumbest shit ever.
It is. I don't disagree.
It is the dumbest shit ever. Like, and what's like worse than that is like, to me, like people capitalizing on like certain like trends and shit, you know, and like, yeah, like I wrote this record to cope with, like, you know, the loss of my dog, you know, and you're just like, dude, come the fuck on. Like, come the fuck on. Like, you know, write a song. Don't like try and like capitalize on some sort of like, you know, what drives me insane is like people who are like, obviously, like, okay, so here's like a great example. Here's what's like really infuriating about like that power bottom thing to me.
Yeah.
Is like, you know, their whole message was like this like fun, you know, acceptance, inclusive thing.
Yeah.
And like now it seems like, you know, I mean, this isn't what really bugs me about him. What really bugs me about like the fucking thing is that like this dude is potentially like a fucking rapist. Like that's by far the worst thing. But another thing that bugs me is like it seems as if now that we know this about him, it's like they're capitalizing on what's basically a cultural trend towards empathy in order to further like their shit.
Absolutely. That's something you've sort of put to words something that I've thought for a little bit where like, and I thought about this, like especially during the election cycle and all that, where I'm thinking like, and I would sort of put it out as a warning. I wasn't trying to be a buzzkill or anything like that, but I was just trying to be like, you know, like let's not all lose our minds. Is that like when something tries to capitalize on even something as pure and wholesome as tolerance, except that fucking Pepsi commercial.
Oh my like, God.
And I still haven't seen it, but I've read enough things about it.
Don't watch it.
No, I feel like I don't have to.
You don't.
But the point I want to make there is that like even something as, you know, sort of, you know, you would think as universal as tolerance or acceptance or just letting everyone be, when that can be co-opted and capitalized as like,
oh my God,
a message, I'm just,
oh my God.
And I want to tell people, I'm like, look, you know, just because, you know, just because Nike gave some money to a thing that we like, Nike is not your friend. Target is not your friend.
Right.
Apple is not your friend. They don't care about you. They're not a living, breathing being with feelings about anything. They are a major multinational corporation and their point is to make money.
Well, yeah,
at the highest levels possible.
See, the thing is, like, people a lot of times
anthropomorphize corporations.
Well, it's like we misinterpret them wanting us to have a positive consumer experience as, you know, them wanting us to have a positive human experience.
Yeah, yeah. This is like, look, we made this MacBook nice. I'm like, okay, that's great. Thank you for making my computer nice, but like, I don't need to feel like you need to tuck me in the bed at night, pat me on the head, and then tell me I'm okay.
The primary ingredient to your MacBook is love.
Yes, yes, because it's not, because that's not a thing.
It's not.
Yeah, no, I absolutely agree with the sort of capitalizing on acceptance in the case of a band like that, capitalizing on, like, I don't even think they're capitalizing, but like, you know,
queer-friendly
stuff, like, you know, inclusive of all these other aspects that, you know, maybe have seemed, you know, somewhat marginalized over years. And that's, I mean, that is a positive thing. So I'm kind of curious what it means in the end if that, like, you know, supposedly the first harbingers of, you know, queer culture in pop music, the first, like, this kind of generation of it, if kind of right out the gate,
yeah,
it can already get marred like that. I'm not saying there's no hope for anything, but it's just,
it is insane.
I don't know what to, that's the thing that I don't know what to do with.
There's nothing to do with it, man. Just like, don't be that fucking guy. Like, you know what I mean?
Like, I think that's like a whole life lesson.
Don't be that
fucking
guy. Like, don't like associate with that guy. Like, you know, my like rule is this, man. I surround myself with like people who are like better people than I am, better musicians than I am,
absolutely,
smarter people than I am. And I hope one day, you know, my goal is to have such a friend group that I aspire to be like any one of them.
Yeah.
And I feel like, you know, setting yourself, you know, examples within your life like that is the best way to become the person that you ultimately want to be. And I think a lot of that, you know, can also be said about, you know, how you consume culture. You know, surround yourself with things that are thoughtful and beautiful and good. And like, hopefully, you know, your art will reflect those things as well.
Yeah, and things that challenge you too.
Yeah, well,
don't just live in a safe bubble of stuff that just sort of just placates you.
No. Yeah. Definitely challenge yourself constantly.
And I definitely think that your EP is challenging, even just listening to it a couple of times. Yeah. I thought to myself, I'm like, well, this is great, and I like this, and I think I can wrap my head around what's going on here. But as I listen to it, especially as that last track kind of finishes out, I'm just like, I gotta listen to this again. I gotta see what's going on. Like, maybe I'll find a different layer, and maybe something else will reveal itself to me when I go in again. Because that's because when I was listening to it on the train, I listened to it twice in a row.
Yeah. Oh, cool.
And it was cool. And it's cool to do that. I mean, how often do you do that with records
anymore?
Not very
often.
But yeah, but it's a great record.
Thank you, man.
I look forward to the next piece and then the following piece. Wow. So 2017 is like really going to be a year of. Of things released by you.
Yeah.
No, that's great. We'll have to check in again when the other ones start to come out.
Yeah.
I'd be interested to see where you are as a human as the things continue to come out. Because I will tell you, you're at an age where things aren't done changing yet. And
yeah, well, I hope not.
and for you to be able to like put out music that's sort of reflecting your state of mind as it's happening is a very interesting window into what's going on.
So
I look forward to it, man. Thanks so much for stopping by.
Oh, dude, thank you so much for having me, dude. It was really a pleasure. This
awesome.
Is like a really awesome space you got here.
Thank you.
So it's there. We're here. Like, it's tomorrow, right?
Yeah.
That's good. 10 people.
Are we doing this right now?
Well, we're on, yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I ambushed you again.
Yeah.
I do that. Mm. We're rolling.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. So it's tomorrow night. I mean, this is going to be out after it happens. But like,
yeah,
so like 10 people on stage?
Yeah.
How
would,
like, so what's the breakdown on that? Like, five drummers?
We got a drummer, we got two horn players, two string players, mm-hmm. Bass player, guitarist, another guitarist. Or I guess Sean is just like kind of like, this dude Sean from this band, Ruby the Hatchet, mm-hmm. He plays with us, he plays like the auxiliary stuff.
Oh, yeah, and,
he's just like kind of floating around.
An everyman?
Yep.
Yep.
And then me, I'll be singing and stuff.
Yep. You gonna wear a suit of some kind?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. I got the velvet, like, red velvet blazer.
Mm-hmm.
And it's nice, because, like, I have everyone in my band wear black, and then I wear the red velvet blazer, because, you know, at the end of the day, right, it's like, it's all about me.
Yeah. It's like a wedding.
Yeah.
You have to have the nicest dress.
Yeah, I'm
the nicest dress. Yeah, no, it's true. But now it's upon us, the release. Some people sort of greet the release as like, thank God it's over, because you've been sort
That's
of birthing, the, you've been birthing this thing for, to all of us out in the world. We're just like, ooh, it's a new thing
that
Deadfellow did. But for you, you're just like, my God, I've been living with this thing for a year.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I hate this thing. I'm done with this thing. I'm very much done with it. Like, you know, it's like, I feel like, you know, some people like raise kids and then like when they get to 18, they're like, see ya.
Get out.
That's how I am with this.
Man, with this record.
Yeah.
Well, you said they're all linked together though, right?
Yeah. Yeah, they're all linked together.
Yeah. And you've got the third one coming out later on this year in the fall.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's talk. I mean, I am very fascinated by the idea of a live band, and the idea of the 10-man live band.
Yeah.
And how, at least for me, from having been a live musician and a touring musician, the idea of getting even four guys in a room together and getting it straight is hard enough. It is really an undertaking to bring in that many people.
You know what? It's easier to do with a solo project because you don't have to worry about anybody's like feelings or whatever. You don't have to worry about, like, you know, it's like if your drummer can't make it, fine, you get a new drummer for that gig. You know what I mean? Like, I got like third string dudes like all the way down. You know what I mean? The that's not even like the biggest outfit that we're trying to play with. We just got announced for that Philly Fest at XPN, the World Cafe Live event. And you know, we're playing with some like pretty good people on like a pretty good night, so we're bringing like the whole outfit out, and for that I think we're gonna do like 15 pieces.
Wow. I like that sort of ambition.
Right. Oh yeah,
it's
way over ambitious, dude. Like,
but
you know,
it's
what?
Great, and you might as well, because
I have people who can like pull that shit off.
Yep.
Like,
if you can do it, do it. Yeah.
Well, see, like, that's like the thing. So the other dude, or the other, like, I guess they're like some core people in this group. Man, I'm hitting hard S's right now. I'm sorry for when you have to.
That's
edit
what the
this.
Thing is there for.
Yeah. The you know, once so the two dudes I primarily work with, or the, I guess the dude that I primarily work with, Carl Readers, he, you know, we arrange a lot together, and like, you know, he helps me produce the stuff in the studio. You know, so he is the director for like the backing band. So he, and he's like way better, like, you know, as far as like a theoretical, yeah, you know, like kind of brain.
He's got an arrangement head. He's got a composition head.
It's not even that so much. Like, I, you know, I hum like a lot of like the, you know, I do like a lot of the composition or whatever. Yeah. He helps me flesh it out. So yeah, I mean, yes, yes.
He's a band leader.
Exactly.
You're the front man, but he would be considered
more or less. Yeah, yeah, sure. The,
these are all old term, old timey stage terms.
Well, I mean, well, what's nice is like, I, you know, I can just kind of, he kind of gets off on like setting up the band or whatever. So like, you know, it's really nice because I can have my cake and eat it too. You know, I can write the songs and sing the songs and it's as simple as I want it to be. And then I can also have this like crazy fucking like arrangement, you know, with it as well, you know.
Because in the end, it's the song.
Yeah.
It's... It can be this core, tiny, it can be this very core, very stripped down thing, or it can be this larger, extravagant thing, or it can be probably many different combinations
in
between, depending on how you feel it. And that's, you know, like all good songs, it kind of doesn't, I mean, if at its core the song is good, then 15 people, one guy, it's going to be a good song.
Yeah. I, you know, I just surround myself with people who are significantly better than I am.
Oh yeah, I was always the same way too. Yeah. I don't want to be the best guy in the room.
Oh, I'm by far the least qualified person to play with my own band.
Where does how did you guys find everybody?
You know, you hire, you know, you get one or two good musicians on, they know two other good musicians, and the other two musicians can give them referrals, and then before you know it.
Yeah, yeah, that's always, it's always a good networking right there. It's like, oh, it's like, oh, you need horns? I got these guys that we just played horns with. And then you call up, and then next thing you know, you've got a whole band. Well, what else are you going to be working on after that? Like, is the third record done, or?
The third record is mostly written. You know, it's going to be, it's going to be good, I think. It's going to be weird. It's going to be a super weird record. Just like the formatting of it's going to be very strange. And not in like a, wow, look at that crazy thing like he did. That's so, it's just going to be fucking weird.
Yeah. Are we talking like non-tonal? Like,
Yeah, we're like working in semitones.
Gamelan or like, you know, drones and things like that.
But lots of like interludes. Mm-hmm.
It's from more of a formatting standpoint. So it's less of a straight kind of pop song format. And
well, what I want to do is like, I'll tell you about this in private.
Okay. I was about to say that I don't want you to give away the show before, and or even before you've even gone in and done it, because who knows. But getting back, so you and Philly, these are like the first recordings that you did.
Yeah, man. You know, this is like kind of like the first time that I had like an actualized or, you know, like a cohesive sort of idea of what I wanted to do. And then, so I was like, fuck it, I'm going to do it. And so I did it, and here I am.
Did you have songs in mind beforehand and you sort of worked them in, or did you kind of come up with the idea?
No. That's why, like, you know how there's like that sound that like fucking everyone's shit like just fucking has? You know what I'm talking about? Like, if you listen to like a lot of fucking, it doesn't happen with like everyone, but there's like a very specific sound that is frequent in like any scene.
Like in production or in...
It's not like a... Well, I mean, well, yeah, there's like definitely the production thing where like
just, or in songwriting or just...
Just as an album as a whole, like it just seems like there's not like a real cohesiveness to everything. It just kind of like deals with like the same like sort of subject matter.
I'd agree with that.
It literally sounds like someone like wrote 50 songs and then picked their favorite 8.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, and like that was what I was like doing, and then I was like, well, that's gonna sound like I had 50 songs and picked my favorite 8, so I'm just gonna write fucking 8 that
go together.
You're gonna
write 8 new ones that go together,
or 6 and then 7.
So when you sat down to like write these, you kind of had an idea. You might not have had an idea of what the entire cohesiveness is going to be, but you were writing them as a crop. You were being like, these are going to go together.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
somehow.
The first album, yeah, that's kind of what happened. The second one, I went in with like a lot of intention and knocked the shit out in like a fucking weekend writing. Yeah.
You had an idea. You're like, it's kind of nice to sort of draw yourself that pen, like that fence right there, and just be like, we're going to live in this area for this record. And then when we're done, we don't have to live in this area anymore. Yeah. We can go make a new area to live in from record to record, which just sounds like what you say is sort of happening from release to release. Each record goes together, but each record is definitely made in its own sort of...
Yeah, and it's a good way like not to take it so seriously as well. Like, I'm motivated by like humor a lot.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I'm like willing to like do something extra because I think it'll be funny.
Yeah.
Then like, you know... So, like, that's, like, another, like, thing that I kind of like about, you know, working on, like, you know, projects as a whole, like, you know, really cohesive, like, you know, conceptual projects.
Yeah.
Because, like, in kind of everything, like, you know, it lets you, in a more organized way, go through, like, the spectrum of, like, you know, personal experience, and you can have like sad experiences and like, you know, happy experiences and funny experiences and like all sorts of things. So it's like nice to kind of tick it off there.
Well, it's nice to have limitations too.
Yeah,
so
definitely.
That you just don't lose your mind.
Yeah.
You sit down and write a song, you're just like, this could literally be anything.
Yeah.
But if you have a plan, like not even a plan isn't the right word at all, but like if you have... Aesthetic isn't the right word at all either.
You have like an outline?
Yeah, you just you're coming in with a point of view.
Central
this is gonna be my point
a thesis.
Of view.
Yeah. You're coming with a thesis.
Yeah,
that's kind of how I like.
Yeah, we're gonna live within this realm for this amount of songs.
Yeah.
And then we will be done. Or we'll go further with it. You know, it's kind of the joy of it right there where you can kind of because limitation I think I did that recently too with a project with someone where we were sort of writing in the vein of I think it was Power Pop.
Yeah.
We just said Power Pop and we took four different guys. And four different guys interpreted that and brought it all back to the table.
Yeah.
And then you have a cohesive thing when it's done.
Yeah.
But it was fun to live in that world where you're just like, whatever song I write, it needs to channel what I understand this thing to be.
Yeah, dig it. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. And then you come out, and then I don't know. You feel like you can almost market success a little more. It was like, did this hit the thesis? Did this hit the point I was making?
Yeah. And also, like, another thing that I've noticed is that it kind of like shifts responsibility away from like, you know, you and onto like the concept.
Yeah, yeah.
Like it's no longer like, you know, is this dude bad? It's like, is this a bad concept?
Yeah.
Which is like kind of, you know, nice.
Well, you can serve the greater idea.
Yeah.
You can kind of let the idea, you can give the idea legs, let it walk around a little bit, and you can just be like, nah, I just made it, and it's doing that.
Yeah.
It's, I mean, I imagine like people who write fiction, like authors and stuff, that's probably how they feel to a point.
Yeah, well, for sure.
At some point, because I often read that with fiction writers, say like, at some point, the characters start doing things, and you're just like, I didn't tell you to do that, but you're doing it, so, you know, let's see what happens. If you can't surprise yourself to a point, then like... I don't know, maybe you're not trying hard enough.
Yeah, well, yeah, definitely. Or, like, maybe you're just being too tight with it, you know what I mean? Like, I write, like, fast and loose, and, you know, I edit, you know, a little bit here and there, but, like...
Well, I think that's a good key as well, is being able to edit your own work,
Right, but, like, what I do is I, like, just sing gibberish over, like, chord progressions.
I do that, too.
Yeah, I'll let it be there, like...
And every once in a while, the gibberish starts to come back and form words, and then when you go back and listen to the gibberish, you're just like, well, it's just, I say it enough times, like, well, it's as good a place to start as any
there.
Like, even if it's just, like, part of a word, or I find when I do gibberish on verses, by the third verse, it's, like, starts to be more words than it was in the first time, and you're just like... All right, well, and I remember reading like David Byrne or something like that kind of approached lyric writing the same way. So again, I felt like, well, I'm in good company.
Yeah, I've always kind of wanted to do that like Burroughsian, like sort of like cut up method.
Yeah.
That's kind of interesting.
Oh, kind of like I'd read that was sort of like what the lyrics Kid A kind of ended up being like almost.
I didn't know that.
And I don't know if it's true. I mean,
I know Bowie did that a little bit.
Oh, yeah, he did that on, the one that I love, Low.
Yeah.
That's why the lyrics to Low are so not like any other Bowie lyrics. Yeah. And that's why there's so few of them. And that's another way you said of sort of like distancing yourself from it and just being like, look, I let the process dictate it. I'm not necessarily dictating what's happening right here. Which Yeah, which can be good to sort of let go and just be like, this is the process. I'm following the process. And whatever comes out of it, comes out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And if it works, it works. And if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. But, you know, that's the process we're working with right now.
Yeah.
It is cool that you have this mapped out. Like,
yeah.
It is to have a project that you're kind of going to... And so when it's done, mm-hmm. you're going to be... You can sort of gauge it on a larger scale and just sure. be like, here's what I thought this stage of this process was going to be like at the beginning, and now here we are now. I just think it's a very, very cool way to do a record, because so often records kind of get done fairly quickly. They're very much limited within the moment and time of when they get made, and that can be great. Like, you can yes. just have this little artifact of like, well, this is where we were in this month that yes. we made the record. And I also think it's cool to have something larger spanning that you've been sort of plugging away at for a yeah. while. It's a grand opus. You're going to have a massive artistic statement when this is over.
Jeez.
For whatever, for all the good yeah. and bad.
I mean, well, you know, honestly, I was just trying to put out a catalog to like just get myself, you know, just there, and yep. then, you know, after this third one comes out, then I'm really going to start working. Seriously.
Yeah.
Seriously, you know.
You're just trying to put out a body. Well, I mean,
I just needed to like make a body of work that was yep. like cohesive and like, you know, multidimensional and like, you know, showed a little, you know, bit of like versatility.
Yeah.
And
some then, growth from point A yeah, to and to now, point B. Yeah.
Then, you know, the album after that, I'm thinking about calling like Motorcycle or MTEL, and it's going to be like 14 tracks. And actually, don't put this in there. I don't want to talk about that yet.
I don't know any of the things you just said. Like, I don't okay. know. I don't know what any of that
okay.
is.
Okay. I already have the album after the third one kind of coming around. I'm going to take my time with that one.
Well, that's good, because some people never know what they're going to do from one song to the next or one record to the next. So
I'm a very spontaneous planner.
No, that makes sense. That absolutely makes sense. I know exactly what you mean
yeah.
right there. You want to play some songs on the guitar?
Yeah.
You're terrified to do that.
That sounds good to me. No, I'm not. Okay. It'll be fine.
Cool. We're going to get that set up. So what song do you want? What song is this?
This is from the third album coming out in the fall. Because, I mean, by the time this airs,
yeah. people can get both the previous records up yeah. there too. And with Mesa California being such a cool studio piece.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's from the new record. It's going to be called Millennials in Love and Other Pre-Apocalyptic Standards.
I remember you told me that. That was great. I thought it was a great title.
And the song is called If Tomorrow Morning Doesn't Come. Okay?
Yeah.
All right. Be afraid of what may come to be. Babe, it's only gravity. There's nothing to do. You asked me if I believe that love's longevity could be confined to mortal brevity, even if that love was true. Well, if tonight, babe, while we're sleeping in your bed, suicidal strangers all begin to lose their heads, till one grabs his button and he pushes it and says, good night, everybody, it's been fun. I love you still. If tomorrow morning doesn't come, one day, babe, love might just survive the human race. Appropriation and the mess we made to finally be free. And when we end up the proverbial dust in the wind, ex-miracles of modern medicine, will that be it for you and me? We'll live somewhere out there, a glacier were to fall, generate a tidal wave 1,000 miles tall. And with its weight and crushing death, it loomed there should have fallen to swallow all there is and ever was. I love you still. Doesn't come.
That's great.
Thanks.
I like that. Yeah, it sounded beautiful.
I got kind of in my head there for a second.
No. I look forward to hearing many many things that you're gonna do at some point or another.
Cool, dude. Yeah, thank you for having me on, dude. I really appreciate it, man.
No, thanks for coming. Thanks for playing.
Yeah, I like talking to you, man. Of course, I'm happy to do it.
Awesome, and have a good show tomorrow, man.
Yeah, thank you. We'll be together till the end of time. 24. Well,
that's the show for this week. Thank you so much for hanging out. Thank you for listening. Huge thanks to Hayden Sammak, Dead Fellow, for coming to the studio, not once, but twice, to just make sure that we got a good conversation in. And I'm glad he came back again. I'm glad he played. I'm glad we could talk. Go to deadfellow.com. All the music that you need of his is there. The new record, Mesa, California, is out June 23rd. You can hear samples on his SoundCloud. Get there through deadfellow.com. Great record. The one before is really great, too. And as I said in the conversation, I very much look forward to hearing the third installment of this whole project to come out. So, yeah. Thanks, Hayden. Go to deadfellow.com. And go to 25oclockpod.com as well and check out the archives and check out the mailing list and check out the Friends and Neighbors page where I give links to anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. Do that. Once again, I'm going to remind you, July 14th at Bridge Set Sound at 7th and South Streets in Philadelphia, I'll be taking part in the 5th annual Philadelphia Podfest, phillypodfest.com. I'll be doing a live show, also doing a live show that night at Bridge Set are The Great Albums Podcast, good friends of mine, and the gentlemen of the Bridge Set Sound Podcast, also good friends of mine. It's going to be a great night of me hanging out with my friends and hopefully hanging out with you too. July 14th, 8 p.m. Bridge Set Sound. Ooh, that's great. Stay cool out there, everyone. The heat's supposed to break soon. It's summer. It's what it does. I don't know why I'm upset. I'm looking at these running shorts, and it's just reminding me of every way that I've failed as a fitness human being. But that's fine. Whatever. I'm all right. I'm fit. I'm good. I ride my bike. I try not to eat too much. I try to eat good things. I try and be active. It's going to be fine. Anyway, thanks for listening to this show. This has been 25 O'Clock. I'm Dan Drago. Until next time, take care of yourselves.